各位佛友，大家晚上好。
Good evening to everybody who has come to listen to the Dharma this evening.
我们现在准备上课，首先请大家发菩提心。
Before we start tonight's lesson, may everyone listen by generating bodhicitta.
那么菩提心呢？我们在这个之前每天都给大家介绍过了。
Up until now, we've been explaining the meaning of bodhicitta at every night's lesson.
那么今天我们上课的时候呢，同样也要给大家提心，发菩提心。
And tonight, likewise, we're also going to remind ourselves about the importance of generating bodhicitta.
那么发菩提心，首先要有这个慈悲心。
So in order to generate bodhicitta, what we firstly need is compassion.
慈悲心就是说我们发自内心的也就是从骨子里向希望天下所有的众生远离一切痛苦远离一切痛苦，这个叫做悲心。
And when we talk about bodhicitta or compassion, what we're referring to is generating from the very depths of our heart the sincere aspiration that all living beings be free from suffering.
然后发自内心的希望天下所有众生拥有心腹这个就叫做慈心。
and generating the sincere aspiration from the depths of our hearts that all living beings obtain happiness.
然后这个菩提心呢，就在这个慈悲心的基础上，还有多了一个内容。
And bodhicitta is built upon the foundation of compassion with one extra element.
那么多了一个内容是多了什么呢？就是不仅仅是希望天下所有的众生远离痛苦拥有幸福，而且就是下决心下决心我们每一个人自己去让天下所有众生幸福快乐远离痛苦，这样子的决心就是菩提心。
So in addition to the hope and wish that all beings be free from suffering and that all beings obtain happiness, when we talk about bodhicitta, we're also talking about the conviction, undertaking the resolve to help all beings obtain happiness and be free from suffering.
然后要天下所有的众生离苦得乐，这个我们以任何一个世俗的这个方法是没有办法达到这个目标。
However, in order to help all beings obtain happiness and be free from suffering, unfortunately, there is no means in the mundane world to enable this to happen.
所以必须要成佛成了佛才能够这个达到这个目标。
So for this reason, it's essential that we achieve awakening in order to achieve our goal of liberating all beings.
好，我们现在大家发菩提心我们如果能够发自内心的去想，那当然是非常非常好的如果我们暂时还没有达到这样子的这个标准的这个菩提心也没关系就是勉强的去向我要让天下所有众生成佛这个解脱，所以我要成佛这样子勉强的去向，也算是一个菩提心。
So right now we're going to generate bodhicitta in respect of tonight's teaching. Of course, it's wonderful if we're able to do this in a really sincere and heartfelt way.But if we're not, for the time being, able to do that, then in some ways compelling ourselves telling ourselves that we are going to listen with the aspiration that all beings be freed from suffering and obtain happiness in a perhaps slightly more contrived way is okay for now. It's an okay place to begin from.
发了菩提心以后我们就将今天的这个课的主题的内容。
After we've generated bodhicitta, we'll move on to the subject of this evening's teaching.
然后我们今天的这个课的题目是如何证悟。
The topic of tonight's teaching is how to become awakened.
好，首先我们讲为什么要证悟。
First of all, we're going to discuss why should we become awakened.
宗喀巴大师有一本书叫做《三主要道》。
宗喀巴 has a scripture called The Three Principal Paths to Enlightenment.
那么宗喀巴大师的这个三主要道是什么意思呢？三就是一二三主要道，道有很多的道我们学佛的时候有很多的道有很多的修道，但是呢其中最关键最关键最主要的不可缺少的就有三个道，叫做三主要道。
And this three principal paths to enlightenment refers to the fact that even though there are numerous paths that we can take to enlightenment or awakenment, there are three in particular that we absolutely can't do with that are absolutely essential, and thus they're the principal three paths.
那么三主要道是什么呢？第一个 就是处离心。
The first of these principal paths is renunciation, the heart of renunciation.
第二就是菩提心。
The second is bodhicitta, the mind of awakening.
第三就是证悟空心。
And the third is realizing the nature of emptiness.
好，就是处离心、菩提心、证悟空心，啊，就在这三个当中呢，整个佛教的所有的，这个内容都包含了。
And within these three principal paths, renunciation, bodhicitta, and realizing the nature of emptiness, the entire contents of the Buddha's teaching is encapsulated.
然后这三个，前后都有因果的关系。
And between the relationship between each of these three paths or components have, they're all interconnected and interdependent.
也就是说，如果没有处离心，就不会有菩提心。
That is to say, without renunciation, it won't be possible for us to generate bodhicitta.
如果没有菩提心，也就是说不能证悟空心。
And by the same token, if we don't have bodhicitta, it won't be possible for us to realize emptiness.
所以这三个都是前后有关系，前后有因果的关系。
And thus, these three principal paths are interconnected in nature. They have a relationship of cause and effect.
我们最终，让我们解脱的这个最有力、最有效的这个方法是证悟空性。
Ultimately, the most efficacious way for us to, achieve awakening is to realize the nature of emptiness.
但是如果没有出离性和菩提心的基础，直接修空心，这个不会成功的。
However, if we lack the foundation, a foundation in renunciation and bodhicitta, then we won't be able to achieve the realization of emptiness.
所以我们无论是在东方或者是在西方，都有一群这样子的人。
So, regardless of whether we're talking about in Asia or in the West, there, are inevitably people who fall into this category.
那么什么样的一群人呢？他们就是不想修处离心和菩提心这些基础的这些修法。
And what is this category that I refer to? It's the type of person who is simply not interested in generating or cultivating renunciation and bodhicitta. They are purely concerned with realizing the nature of emptiness.
他们就想走一条捷径，走一条快速的路，直接向修，大圆满证悟空心。
They're the kind of person that wants to take the fast lane, the fast track to realizing emptiness and practicing the teachings of the great perfection.
但是大家必须要知道，这个是根本不可能的。
However, everybody needs to know that this simply isn't possible.
所以我们，如果要证悟空性，那么就是要一步一步的去学修。
So, if we are going to realize the nature of emptiness, it's important that we take it step by step in terms of our study and practice.
就像我们读大学，那么必须要有小学和中学的基础才可以读大学。
It's the same as our university studies. If we don't have a foundation in primary school and secondary school, then we clearly can't go on to college.
如果我们从来没有上过小学或者上过这个中学的课，那么直接去读研究生、读博士，这个不会成功的。
If we attempt to go straight into a master's program or a PhD program without having the foundations of, prior education, then we're simply not going to attain any success.
还有，我们任何一个，这个实务的工作。比如说，做生意，或者是做其他的事情，都做任何事情都必须要有它的基础。
Actually, any kind of work, any kind of worldly job or task that we put ourselves to in the world, all they similarly require their own kind of foundation in order to be successful.
有了这个过程， 最后才会有这个结果。
It's through the progress of laying the foundation that we ensure we can obtain the ultimate result.
那么没有这个过程啊，就不会有结果。所以我们啊，不像修这些基础的修法，直接向证悟大圆满，这完全是不可能的。
Without this process, without the process that leads up to the result, we simply can't take the result. So, we won't achieve the result. So, to aim to realize the nature of emptiness by, you know, following the Dzogchen teachings without having laid the proper foundations isn't a viable approach.
我听他们说啊，西方人就是学佛的西方人。啊，最喜欢大圆满。
I've heard that Westerners, in particular, like or are very much find the Dzogchen teachings extremely appealing.
也许西方的华人也是这样子。
And perhaps the people of Chinese background in the West are the same.
那么，如果我们喜欢大圆满的话，那必须要喜欢大圆满的基础。
But if people find the Dzogchen teachings appealing, then they also need to find the Dzogchen preliminaries or foundation appealing.
我们建一座大楼啊，那么首先啊，不是建这个楼，首先就是要建好这个楼的基础。
When we are going to construct a big building or something, we don't go straight into building the upper edifice. We have to build or make the foundation first.
然后就是从一楼、二楼、三楼、一层一层的建。
And from there on, build each floor one on top of the other, one at a time.
并不是空中先修第二十层楼，然后再修第十九层楼，再修十八层楼。
And what we don't do certainly is in the middle of thin air start by building the 20th floor, the 19th floor, the 18th floor.
同样的，我们修大圆满，我们喜欢大圆满，这个当然是非常好的事情。但是呢，大圆满它也有它的基础。
Of course, that we all really attracted to the Dzogchen teachings is a wonderful thing indeed. But the Dzogchen teachings do have their necessary foundation.
然后我们把它的这个基础的部分啊，都放弃啊，执着。它的这个最后的一部分啊，这个不符合啊，这个它的要求。
But if we don't pay attention to the foundation and instead concentrate only on the result, then this is in complete contradiction with the prerequisites for this practice.
那么宗喀巴大师讲的这个三主要道啊，那它是代表所有的藏传佛教，所有藏传佛教都是这样子。
So the three principal paths that Tsongkhapa describes in his text encapsulate the approach taken by all of the traditions of Tibetan Buddhism.
不仅仅是藏传佛教，所有的大乘佛教都是这样子。
And not just Tibetan Buddhism, but in fact, all of Mahayana Buddhism conforms to this approach.
虽然我们最终极的目标是真悟空性啊，但是呢为了证悟空心，所以要修它的这个前提的这些这个修法。
Of course, our ultimate goal is definitely to realize the nature of emptiness. But in order to do so, we need to apply ourselves to the necessary preliminary stages or foundational prerequisites.
那么前提的这个修法。第一个是出离心。
So the first of these preliminary requisites is the cultivation of renunciation.
那么出离心它的具体的修法就叫做释迦心。
The concrete means of cultivating renunciation is the four common preliminaries.
然后释迦心首先是人生难得。我们必须要知道我们的这个生命是来之不易千载难逢就是一个非常非常不容易的很难得的 首先要有这样子的这个对生命的这个认知这个需要修人生难得的修法。
So, the first concept that we need to practice in order to cultivate renunciation is cultivating an awareness and appreciation of the preciousness of human life.
当我们深深地体会到我们的人生是非常不容易这样子的时候呢，我们才懂得珍惜这个生命。
Only when we realize the rareness of this human life, this human form that we've taken in this lifetime, are we in a position to really proceed in our practice.
所以我们的这个实修的第一门课，第一个功课就是要修人生难得。
So the first part of our practice, the first task that we need to apply ourselves to is cultivating an appreciation for the rareness of our human lives.
人生难得就是要肯定我们的生命的价值。
What this is doing is affirming the value of our human lives, the human forms we've taken.
当我们了解这个生命非常有价值的时候，我们才知道怎么样去用这个生命，才是最有意义的。
It's only after we develop an appreciation of the value for our lives that we are in a position to really know about how to use our human existences.
第二个修法就叫做死亡无常。
The second task.That we need to apply ourselves in cultivating renunciation is that of death and impermanence.
我们的这个人生来之不易，要获得一个这样子的人生非常非常的难，但是呢，失去这个人生是非常容易的事情。
Even though attaining this human life is an extremely rare and difficult thing, losing it, on the other hand, is extremely easy.
我们的生命它实际上就是非常非常的脆弱，随时说没就没了。
This human life of ours, in fact, is an extremely flimsy thing. At the click of our fingers, you know, we may lose it, it might vanish and disappear.
当我们发现人生很短暂，而且随时都有可能失去这个人生的时候呢，然后我们就知道要做的事情要赶紧做。
Only when we realize that this life of ours is extremely ephemeral and that we could lose it at any time, are we able to realize what we really need to do then in our lives?
第三个修法就叫做轮回的痛苦。
The thirdpractice that we need to undertake is suffering of samsara.
那么这个轮回当中有太多太多的这个痛苦。
Within our samsaric existences, we have so much suffering.
释迦牟尼佛他不是一个悲观主义者。
The Shakyamuni Buddha was not a pessimist.
他也不是一个他的观点也不是一个小鸡的人生观。
His view of life or worldview also can't be described as being negative in nature.
但是他让我们一定要知道这个轮回的真相。
Nevertheless, he was concerned that we absolutely need to know the truth of our existence.
我们通常就会用一些美好的词汇来覆盖这个轮回的真相。
Quite often we use very elaborate and fancy turns of phrase, pleasant sounding turns of phrase, in order to conceal the nature, the true nature of our lives and existences.
比如说我们的这个未来充满阳光等等。
For example,The future is full of sunshine.
我们的未来 没有什么阳光，就是衰老和死亡，就是我们的未来。
In fact, there is no sunshine in the future. All the future holds for us is suffering and death.
释迦牟尼佛他不喜欢啊这些带有欺骗性的词汇。
Sakyamuni Buddha did not like words that were deceptive in nature.
他让我们正视轮回人生。
He was concerned that we confront the reality of our existences.
但是呢，在这个之后，释迦牟尼佛然后给我们推出一个，虽然这个轮回很痛苦，但是呢，如果你想解决，那么用这种方法去解决，就是他立即给我们提供了一个解决的方法。
However, even though this existence is suffering, Sakyamuni Buddha provided us with a way out of it. If we want to be free from this samsaric world of suffering, he provided us with a path.
那么轮回当中有太多的这个痛苦，这个我们21世纪的人基本上都能够理解这句话的意思。
The idea or the notion that samsara is full of suffering is something that probably most people in the 21st century are relatively easily able to appreciate.
为什么说21世纪的时候的人能够理解呢？
Why do I say that it's something people in the 21st century are relatively easily able to understand?
20世纪末和21世纪这个物质生活空前的发达的一个时代。
The later end of the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st are an age in which we enjoy unprecedented material wealth.
在这个之前，我们几乎全世界所有的人都希望物质给我们带来终极的幸福。
Prior to this,Almost all the world's people everywhere had belief and hope in the fact that material richness could bring us happiness.
那么这些想法很多都是从西方开始的。
Many of these notions and ideas originated in the Western world.
然后就是逐渐的就走向全世界。
And then gradually pervaded the rest of the world.
在这样子的思想下，我们就破坏了环境。
Yet, by holding to these notions or believing in these notions, we have destroyed much of the world.
消耗了太多太多的这个资源。
And consumed so many resources.
空气污染、环境污染，有些地方都已经没有办法正常生活。
And polluted the air and environment to an extent that in some places it's no longer possible to live there anymore.
这些都是我们为这个物质生活付出的代价。
And these are the prices that we've paid for this idea of blindly following material accumulation.
那么付出了这么沉重的代价，换来的是什么呢？
So in paying such a heavy price, what have we got in return?
如果19世纪、18世纪的这些哲学家，他们的理论如果没有错的话，那么换来的应该是幸福。
If the theories of philosophers in the 18th and 19th centuries were correct or are correct, then what we should have got by now in return is happiness.
但是我们今天大家都看到、感受到了，换来的不是幸福。
How everybody can see and perceive for themselves that what we've got, in fact, isn't happiness.
换来的就是压力和浮躁。
What we've got instead is pressure and great restlessness.
焦虑和痛苦。
Anxiety and pain.
那么物质不能给我们带来幸福，这样子的话，那么我们现在找不到什么东西真正给我们带来幸福。
So, with material things being unable to bring us happiness, we're in a position where we really can't find anything that will serve to provide us happiness.
所以我们很多人活得非常的茫然。
So for this reason, many, many people live in an extremely
不知道我们的生命的意义何在。
And have no idea of what the meaning of this life really is.
这个就叫做轮回的痛苦。
And this is what we mean when we refer to the suffering of samsara.
我想我们很多人让他们选择、重新来一次、这一生的这样子的人生的话，很多人是不太喜欢，或者很多人是不太高兴的，不太乐意的。
In fact, there are many people, if you gave them a chance of coming back and living this life again, probably wouldn't even want to. They wouldn't be happy to do so.
过去、物质就是我们的一个唯一的、这个依赖、就是我们的依赖的地方。但是呢，现在我们发现这个物质不解决问题的时候，然后很多人、很悲观、很消极、不知道要去做什么。
In the past, this was something we really relied on, a belief that material richness would bring us happiness. But in now discovering this is no longer the case, then many people are in a situation of really not knowing what they can rely on.
但是释迦牟尼佛他没有否定我们的现实生活当中存在的一些幸福和快乐。
Of course, the Sakyamuni Buddha for at no stage denied the possibility or the reality of happiness enjoyment in our concrete everyday lives.
但是释迦牟尼佛觉得这个生、现实生活当中虽然是有幸福，虽然是有这个快乐，但是这些快乐和幸福非常非常的短暂。
Even though we do have happinesses and enjoyments in our everyday real lives, these kinds of happinesses from the point of view of the Buddha are extremely short-lived and ephemeral in nature.
然后这些幸福和快乐呢，它不但是它的寿命很短暂，而且、都是相对的，没有一个绝对的幸福和、快乐。
These joys and happinesses that we have in our everyday lives are relative in nature. They're not ultimate in their essence.
所以释迦牟尼佛觉得、用幸福这两个字来描述这个世界是不太恰当。
So for this reason, the Buddha really didn't feel that describing this world we live in as happy was particularly fitting.
他觉得用痛苦这两个字来形容这个轮回是很合适的。
He felt that a more suitable way of describing the world we live in was to describe it as being filled by suffering.
所以叫做轮回痛苦。
So that's why we say,
那么我们、
the suffering of samsara.
Yeah. 所以我们、这个、人生、当中虽然是有一点这个幸福和快乐，但是呢、大部分的这个、感受、我们的感受都是痛苦和不愉快、郁闷、焦虑、这样子的负面的情绪。
So even though we do have some amount of happiness and joy in our everyday lives, the majority of our experience is more likely to be suffering, pain, anxiety, worry, depression.
但是我们要知道这个人生、虽然不怎么样，但是呢这个是轮回当中、流到轮回当中应该算是很不错的了。
So even though this life of ours might not be up to much, we at the same time need to appreciate that out of the all six potential realms that we could have been reborn in, this human life is a pretty good shot.
其他的就像恶鬼啊、旁生啊这样子的这个生命啊、更加的痛苦。
Hungry ghosts and animals, by contrast, are far more suffering than we humans are.
所以呢啊，佛就是说轮回是痛苦，我们不要沉迷啊，不要沉迷在这个眼前的啊这些。小小的心腹当中、佛鼓励我们超越这一切。
So we don't want to get stuck or bask in these very small kinds of happiness and joy that we experience in our everyday lives.
啊，这个就叫做这个轮回的痛苦第三啊，然后最后第四。
So that concludes the third topic of our meditation or practice, the defects of samsara, the suffering of samsara, and now we're going to move on to the fourth one.
叫做第四，就叫做因果不续。
The fourth is the law of causality.
那么因果不续是什么呢？就是有因就会有果，这个因和果之啊是永远。都不会不会这个错乱。
So, in our lives or in this world, we have cause and effect. When we have causes, we have effects, and this law will never ever be alterable or be able to be undermined or disproven.
因果永远都不虚假，不错乱的意思就是说，善有这个善报，恶有恶报。这个永远都不会虚假，这个就叫做这个因果不续。
So by saying, by talking about the law of causality, what we mean is that this law that cause will generate effect, that good actions will generate good results, bad actions will generate bad results, is unalterable, undeniable, and ultimately unchangeable law of the universe.
我们每一个人都希望自己当做一个有钱人但是呢很多人都不能实现他的梦想。
Of course, most of us probably wish we were very rich people, but not everyone is able to realize this dream.
我们每一个人都希望健康不愿意生病但是呢就要面对这个病痛。
And likewise, you know, everybody wishes that they could enjoy good health and be free from illness, but facing sickness and disease is an inevitability for most of us.
我们不愿意衰老，但是呢，每一个人都要去面对衰老的痛苦。
Nobody wants to age and get older, but this is something we have no choice in facing.
那么我们这些都我们不愿意的东西，那么为什么我们要面对这么多的我们不愿意面对的事情呢？就是因为因果。
Of course, none of these things are things that we want to confront. None of these things are things we want to come to terms with. But why is it that we have to come to terms with and confront so many things that we don't want to? The reason is cause and effect.
健康不健康。贫穷和这个富裕等等很多当然它有很多客观的因素。
Of course, whether we are rich or poor, or whether we're in good health or ill, have many contributing concrete factors.
但是它的主要的一个因素就是善恶因果。
However, the principal reason or the principal cause is in fact the law of cause and effect.That good yields good and bad yields bad.
所以我们为了现实生活就是为了现实的一点点的利益做了很多很多很多对这个其他的众生有害的这样子的事情的话那么这个未来一定要付出代价的。
So if in the course of our everyday existences, in order for a small benefit here or a small benefit we can bring to ourselves in some ways, we inflict harm on others, then it's an absolute certainty that we will have to pay the price for this.
好，这四个修法就叫做四个外加性。
These four practices are what we refer to as the four outer common preliminaries.
然后通过这个四种不同的修法不同的思维的方式最后的结果是什么呢结果就叫做出离心
And it's through cultivating these four practices that we are able to ultimately generate what we refer to as renunciation
出离心是什么呢出离心就是说我们通过这个四种思维的方式思维 认真的去思考了以后呢，就是发现啊，这个人生啊，这个我们的现实生活的真相啊，这样子以后呢，然后我们就会有一个新的想法，或者是新的这个人生的计划。
So, what we mean when we talk about renunciation is that by going through and practicing these four meditations, that we will generate a new attitude or a new approach.
这个新的人生的计划和这个新的发现是什么呢？我们就发现啊，我们像过去一样赚更多的钱，然后呢，就这个为了名，为了利啊，把这个一辈子的时间啊都花在这些上面啊，这个是最终还是不解决问题。
So when we talk about this new plan that will that from our practice of renunciation, a new plan for our lives will emerge. We're really talking about, for example, whereas previously we might have been willing to spend a great deal of energy on accumulating money, a lot of money, or making a lot of money, no longer will we think this way.
然后这个时候就有一种新的想法，就是说，啊，我一定要超越这个生老病死，超越这个轮回啊，这个才是我的啊生命的意义，或者是生命的这个目标。
The new attitude that I refer to is the arising of a thought that I want to and must transcend this samsaric existence, and that this is the meaning of my life.
这个时候我们会发现啊，在这个之前，我们一直都在提升啊我们的身边的这个身外的东西，比如说我们去提升我们的房子，从小到大，然后从公寓楼到这个别墅，我们提升这个我们的房子的级别。
We will find out in, or we'll discover as a result of generating renunciation, that prior to doing so, we were constantly involved in doing things like constantly upgrading the material things in our lives. For example, our apartments from a, or our houses from a small house to a big house, from a small flat to a fancy apartment.
然后我们再考虑啊，这个提升我们的交通工具汽车的这个级别，从普通的轿车到高级轿车，到非常非常昂贵的这个轿车，这样子不断的提升。
Or we were really concerning ourselves with upgrading our cars from a simple small car to then a better car, and ultimately to an extremely fancy car.
然后我们家里啊用的这些电器，我们手里用的手机啊、计算机等等，我们也就是不断的提升。
Or the electronic appliances in our house, or the mobile technology that we use, constantly concerned with this constant upgrading cycle of having better things.
然后衣服从普通的衣服到这个世界品牌，啊，这样子不断的升级。
Or in terms of our clothing, going from having ordinary everyday clothes to having brand name garments.
当我们把这些所有的身外的东西都升级了以后呢，我们会发现自己的生命，或者是我们自己没有升级。
However, after we've, achieved upgrading and upgrading of all these external material things in our lives, what we will ultimately discover is this very life of ours is not in a position to be upgraded.
这个时候，我们会发现，我们的身外的所有的东西都高高在上。
At this particular point in time, we'll discover that all of these external things in our lives are very remote from us.
我们的生命和我们的精神非常的脆弱，就是跪在下面。
And with these material objects looming high above us, we in our weak lives, with our weak lives in existence, are kneeling humbly before them.
这个时候啊，这些身外的东西不但是没有给我们带来幸福，而且反过来给我们的生命带来更多的威胁和更多的痛苦。
And we will see that these external possessions, instead of bringing us greater happiness, are in fact exacerbating our suffering.
这个时候我们会发现啊，这种办法是不对的，所以我必须要提升我自己的生命的级别。
So at this point in time, we will discover this approach is really not a good one to pursue, and what I need to do is focus on upgrading my existence.
这个时候我们就知道啊，我们的生命或者是我们的今生必须要高高在上。
And at this point in time, we will realize that our lives and our spiritual lives are the things that we need to put in this high and elevated place.
所有的身外的东西就在我们的这个生命或者我们的今生之下。
And all of these external elements that we previously revered need to be put beneath us.
啊，这个目标就是我们的新的计划，人生的计划。
And this goal is what I refer to as our new plan of attack or a plan of approach for life.
用佛教的话来讲，这个就叫做出离心。
And using a Buddhist turn of phrase, this is what we refer to by renunciation.
换一句话说，就是这个时候我们想啊，我一定要解脱啊，我不能再这样子下去，这样子下去我得不到幸福，所以我一定要解脱。
Or putting it in another way, what we think at this point is, I really want to be free from this. I want to be liberated.I don't want to be stuck in this situation any longer.
这个决心就叫做出离心。
And it's this conviction that is what we refer to by renunciation.
啊，这个决心啊，这个决心呢，就是我们的以后未来在这个修行的道路上的一个唯一的动力。
And it's this conviction that is the motivation, the compelling force.Behind all of our future practice.
我们这么多人为什么不修心呢？因为他们没有这样子的动力。
And why are there so many people who don't practice? It's precisely because they don't have this motivation.
他们为什么没有动力呢？因为他们看这个世界没有看到它的真相。
And the reason that they don't have this,compelling force behind them is because they have not been able to see the true nature of this existence.
他们的所有的世界观、人生观、价值观都建立在这个世界的表面的现象之上。
Their worldviews and values, etc., are all founded on an extremely superficial layer of existence.
所以他们下不了这样子的决心，就是没有出离心。
So they're not able to generate this conviction, and for this reason, are not able to generate renunciation.
好，当我们有这样子的这个处理性的时候呢，然后我们从此以后我们的这个路线啊改变了。
Once we have this renunciation, then the path we will follow henceforth has completely changed.
所谓的路线的改变啊，在这个之前呢，我们顺着这个生老病死走。那么现在呢，我们有了这个处理心以后呢，我们再也不随着这个生老病死走，我们相反的，我们往另外一个方面走，这个就是选择。
So whereas previously we would have followed an extremely samsaric path in our lives, by cultivating renunciation, we orient ourselves to an entirely different path.
有一句话说得非常的好。
There's one saying that puts this extremely well.
这句话是什么呢？选择比努力更加的重要。
And this phrase is that choices we make are in fact more important than the efforts.
如果我们的选择错了，所有的努力啊都是徒劳，都是白费。
Because if we make a wrong choice, then all of the endeavors and effort that we subsequently make in terms of that choice are ultimately in vain.
如果选择是正确的话，那就是为了这个正确的选择 哪怕是付出了一点点，也是非常有回报的。
However, if our choice in the first place is correct, then even if we only subsequently make a small amount of effort in terms of that choice, we're sure to yield good results.
我们的人生非常的短暂，没有时间啊，就走这么多的弯路，必须要找到一个正确的路。
These lives of ours are so extremely short that we haven't got time. We simply can't afford to take a whole lot of paths that lead to nowhere.
所以这个出离心在藏传佛教里面呢，特别特别的重视。
So for this reason, renunciation is regarded as extremely important in Tibetan Buddhism.
所有的藏传佛教的这些上师，标准的上师，他们要求我们。当我们还没有出离心的时候呢，不允许我们修大圆满，要求我们不要去修大圆满。
All of the qualified masters in the Tibetan tradition stipulate that until we have cultivated renunciation, that we not practice the Dzogchen teachings.
好，这个就是宗喀巴大师讲的三主要道里面的第一个。
So this is the first path that the Venerable Tsongkhapa explains in the three principal paths.
也就是我们的真悟空心啊，真悟大圆满的第一步。
So this is the first step that we take on the path to achieving awakening.
第二步是什么呢？就是五加心。
The second step of the path is embarking on the five inner uncommon preliminaries.
五加心第一个就是要皈依三宝。
The first of these is taking refuge in the triple gem, the three jewels.
这个皈依三宝呢，就是大乘佛教的皈依三宝。
And when we talk of this refuge, we're talking about the refuge in terms of the Mahayana vehicle of Buddhism.
第二个就是修菩提心。
The second stage is to develop bodhicitta.
那么菩提心的重要性，为什么要修菩提心啊？什么叫做菩提心？这个我们这几天都给大家介绍过了，今天不再重复了。
So what is bodhicitta and why is it important? That's something we've talked a lot about in the last couple of days, so I'm not going to repeat it this evening.
然后第三个就是金刚萨埵的修法。
The third stage is Vajrasattva practice.
金刚萨埵的修法呢，它是来忏悔我们的罪过。
So the Vajrasattva practice entails confessing our wrongdoings.
如果我们不忏悔这些罪过的话，我们看不到我们的心的本性。
If we don't confess our wrongdoings, then it's not possible for us to see the essence of our minds.
就像我们找金子的时候，这个金子上面蒙上一层土尘土，那么我们看不到。
It's like if a mirror has a veil of dust on its surface, we're not possible, it's not possible for us to clearly see our reflections in its face.
就在这个镜子上的这些所有的尘土都抹掉，擦干净了以后呢，我们才能够看到。
It's only when we've wiped the mirror free of this veil of dust that we're able to see, clearly see our reflections in it.
同样的道理，我们把这些罪过全部忏悔了，清净了以后，才能够看到心的本心，也就叫做真悟。
It's only so in a comparable manner. It's only after we've confessed all our wrongdoings and purified these negativities that we're able to realize the essence of our minds and become awakened.
第四就是积累福报。
The fourth is the accumulation of merits.
也叫做这个曼扎拉的修法
，which is the mandala offering。
那么积累福报有很多很多积累福报的方法，但是这个所有的方法里面呢，最简单、最有效的就是这个曼扎拉的修法。
Of course, there are innumerable ways that we can go about accumulating merit, but the most simple and effective of them is the offering of mandala.
然后最后一个修法就叫做上师瑜伽。
And then the fifth stage of the five inner preliminaries is Guru Yoga.
这个上师瑜伽呢，它的这个主要的作用就是，通过这个修法啊，获得上师的加持。
The ultimate effect or function or result of practicing Guru Yoga is obtaining the blessings of our teacher.
加持就是一种能量。
Blessings are a type of energy.
那么这个能量，我们获得了这个能量以后呢，可以帮助我们尽快的证悟。
So once we've received or this energy or this power in the form of blessings, we will be able to attain awakening in a quicker manner.
在大乘佛教，尤其是在密宗里面呢，特别特别的重视上师。
The Mahayana tradition and particularly the tantric Tibetan tradition. Regards the Lama or teacher as extremely important.
密法或者是这个是大乘佛教里面，他们为什么这么重视这个上师呢
？Why is it that these traditions regard the teacher as so important？
我们今天我们学佛，我们没有办法这个听到佛陀的亲自的传法。
Of course, in this day and age, it's not possible for us to hear the teachings of the Buddha Dharma from the Sakyamuni Buddha directly.
虽然有很多很多的佛经，那么这些佛经我们自己去看，看不懂。
There are, of course, a lot of sutras, a lot of Buddhist scriptures, but when we read them themselves, ourselves, we don't necessarily understand their contents.
尤其是很多很多的具体的方法，我们更加的没有办法了解。
In particular, a lot of concrete practices that are described in these texts are particularly difficult for us to understand.
那么这一切都要靠我们的上师。
So for all of these things, we need to rely on our teacher.
那么上师对我们来说就是上师给我们完成佛陀给我们要完成的工作。
So we can understand it in terms of our teacher giving us the task to complete, instead of the Buddha giving us the practices that we need to complete in order to attain awakening.
因为至少在这个表面上佛陀离我们有2500多年以上的这么长时间的距离。
After all, there is about 2,500 years between us and the Buddha Sakyamuni.
那么佛陀的思想佛陀的这些智慧传递给我们的最直接、离我们最近的，就是我们的上师。
But the most proximate way that the Buddha's teachings can be transmitted to us is through our teachers.
我们上次也提到过，如果这个上师就像自来水的水龙头。
We previously talked. We use the metaphor of a faucet on a tap to describe the role of our teachers.
释迦牟尼佛的智慧就像我们这个自来水的源头。水库里面的水一样的。
And the teachings of the Buddha are like the water in a reservoir.
那么2500多年的这个这么长的过程当中这些一代一代的这些上师就像这个自来水的管道一样的。
And then the teachers, the masters, the sages, that generation one after the next followed after the Buddha are akin to the water pipe or viaduct that takes the water from the reservoir to the tap.
那么这个水库 关岛、水龙头这些当中我们当然最需要的就是水，但是离我们最近的不是水库，也不是水的管道，就是水龙头。
So of these three, the reservoir, the pipe, and the faucet, of course, what we really want and need is the water, but the one that is closest to us is the faucet.
那么今天我们能不能喝到水，就是要看这个水龙头，要靠这个水龙头。
Now, whether or not today we're going to be able to access water, we're going to be able to drink water, depends entirely on the faucet. That's what we rely on.
所以我们必须要找到一个非常标准的上师。
So for this reason, it's very important that we find for ourselves a qualified teacher.
那么标准的上师就是上师他本身就有修正的这样子的人修正有菩提心有修正的人叫做标准的上师。
And when we refer to a qualified teacher, what we mean is a teacher who has realization through practice and a teacher who also possesses bodhicitta.
因为这样子的人就有这个能量。
Because it's only this type of person that has the power or energy necessary.
菩提心它本身就是有巨大的能量。
Bodhicitta in itself, in intrinsically, has a great, great energy power.
然后通过修心通过修心，那么它就储存了很多的能量。
Through practice, bodhicitta enables us to store and to save up, accumulate a great amount of energy.
那么最后我们修上师瑜伽，以这个上师瑜伽的这个力量去激活或者是启动这个能量的时候呢，然后这个能量就会释放出来的。
So by relying on the practice of Guru Yoga, we're really able to ignite that energy, to really accumulate that energy, ignite it, send it out, and ultimately rely on that energy.
那么这个时候我们所获得的这个上师的加持或者是能量作为一个修心人来说，他一定会亲身感觉到的。
At this point, through the practice of Guru Yoga, the energy that we receive as a result of doing it is something that anyone who sincerely applies themselves to the practice will be able to perceive and feel for themselves.
作为一个不修心的门外汉就是不修心的人的话，那么这个能量他永远都没有办法理解，对他来说永远都是一个很神秘的东西。
But for a person who doesn't actually apply themselves to the practice of Guru Yoga, who only reads about it or who understands it from a non-practice perspective, they'll never be able to experience the nature of this energy. It will always appear to them or seem to them an extremely mysterious, unknowable thing.
那么这个能量，这个加持作为一个虔诚的这个修行人对上师很有信心、很虔诚的佛教徒来说，这个能量一点都不神秘。
But to a practitioner who is extremely sincere in their application to this practice, the energy of blessing that is generated from Guru Yoga is in no way mysterious at all.
他随时随地都可以感觉到这个能量的。这个能量或者是这个价值的存在，不管是现实生活当中或者是在做梦境当中。
They're able to, at any time, in any place, really feel and know the force of this blessing, whether they're engaging in some kind of everyday activity or they're in a state of dreaming.
这个能量上师在的时候或者是不在的时候，圆寂的时候，都是一样的，随时都可以感觉得到，可以体会得到。
This power, this energy, this blessing is something that can be felt very viscerally and really, regardless of whether our teacher is alive or whether he has passed on.
藏传佛教、汉传佛教、印度佛教，这些佛教历史上的这些真正的这些修行人、证悟者，他们都是依靠这个能量啊，最后证悟的。
All of the great realized masters in the Chinese Buddhist tradition, in the Indian tradition, Buddhist tradition, in the Tibetan Buddhism, have all relied on this special power of blessing in order to achieve awakening.
啊，这个就叫做无家行。
So, this is what we refer to as the five uncommon preliminaries.
这无家行也就是一个一个一个的修，要必须要修到最标准。
So each of these five preliminaries need to be practiced one by one, step by step, and each of them practiced to the proper standard.
啊，这个用词错了。啊，不是说不能说必须要收到最标准，必须要收到比较标准的。
We don't necessarily have to practice them to the most standard level, but we have to practice them to a relatively standard level.
对，那么这个是我们证悟空心的第二步。
So this is the second stage of our path to realizing the nature of emptiness.
当我们从修人生难得开始，我们离这个真无空心越来越近，越来越近。
So from the very first practice of meditating and contemplating on the preciousness of the rareness of human existence, everywhere we go from here on in, we get closer and closer to the ultimate goal of realizing emptiness.
这个五家行里面呢，虽然是有五个家行，但是呢，它的核心啊，就是菩提心。
So the five preliminaries, the five inner preliminaries that we just described, even though there's five of them, their ultimate essence is the cultivation of bodhicitta.
还有一个核心的就是上师瑜伽，也是特别特别的重要。
And the other really core practice is, of course, guru yoga, which is extremely important.
好，这个就是宗喀巴大师讲的这个三主要道里面的第二个。
And so these five inner preliminaries are what Tsongkhapa described in his three principal paths to awakening. What I've just described is the second stage or the second of those three paths.
好，这个四加心、五加心啊，每一个加心都是修的比较标准，然后出离心、菩提心都达到比较标准的时候呢，然后啊，这个证悟空性的这些所有的条件，应该说是都具备了。
So it's through practicing the four common preliminaries and the five inner uncommon preliminaries and reaching a relatively good standard of attainment in each of these practices that we will be able to possess or to have the basic conditions in place in order to realize the nature of emptiness.
那么这个无家心和四家心啊，作为一个上班族啊，这样子的人来说，大概也就需要三四年的时间。
For most of us who hold down everyday jobs and lives, probably completing these preliminary practices will require 3 or 4 years of our time.
大概需要三到五年的时间。
Or 3 to 5 years of our time.
啊，但是当然，这个因为每个人的情况不一样，有些人可能会更加的快一点，有些人可能也许会稍微慢一点。
Of course, everybody's individual circumstances do vary, so some might be able to practice somewhat more quickly, whereas others might require a longer period of time.
我们的修心，它是一个漫长的这个过程啊，所以不能急功近利啊，必须要有长远的计划。
Practices the journey that our practice is in fact a long journey. It's an ongoing journey. So, what we shouldn't do is think that we just apply a great amount, a spurt of energy in the beginning. What we need to have is a long-term approach.
然后三到五年这个时间当中啊，这个四加行和五加行修完了以后呢，然后再去修禅定。
So after we've in a over a course of 3 to 5 years, completed these preliminary practices, then we can move on to meditation.
禅定啊，我讲的这个禅定，实际上这个四加心、五加心也叫做禅定啊。禅定有光仪和狭义的这个禅定，在这个光仪的狭啊光义的这个禅定当中啊。四加心、五加心，这些都包含了，这些都叫做禅定。
Of course, when we talk about meditation, we can understand meditation in a broad sense, and also in a more narrow sense. So, if we're understanding meditation from a more, from a more broader sense, then everything we've just described—the four outer preliminaries and the five inner preliminaries—can all be considered a type of meditation.
那么我说的这个时候要修的这个禅定呢，就是下一的这个禅定，也就是己执的这个修法。
But what I'm referring to here in terms of meditation is the more narrow or specific definition of meditation. And here, I'm talking about shamatha meditation or quiescence or abiding.
通过四加心的修法我们已经有了出离心，通过五加心的修法我们已经有了菩提心，但是呢不一定我们的心很平静。
So even though having completed the four common preliminaries and the five uncommon preliminaries, we will have cultivated renunciation and bodhicitta, our minds won't necessarily be able to abide in a state of calmness.
还是会有比较多的杂念。
We'll probably still be in a state where we have many distracting thoughts.
所以在这个基础上啊，出离心跟菩提心的基础上，在这个过渡的时间当中，就要修禅定。
So for this reason, after we've cultivated renunciation and bodhicitta, we need to move on to the cultivation of meditation on calm abiding.
我们现在很多人既没有出离心也没有菩提心，在这样子的基础上去修啊，在这样子的情况下去修这个禅定，那么这个禅定呢只能把我们的心安静，只能给我们缓解一些压力，但是呢这种禅定不能让我们解脱。
SoAt the current point in time, there are a lot of people who practice meditation or calm abiding meditation without having a foundation of renunciation and compassion. Now, without having this foundation, it's possible that without that foundation, that meditation will bring us a certain calmness of state, a calmness of mind. It will alleviate our pressure to some extent, but it won't be able to assist us on the path to awakening.
那么这个禅定啊，要大概也要修1到2年的时间。
So our practice in shamatha meditation is something that will require about 1 or 2 years of our practice.
然后这个7-8年啊，这个时间过去了以后呢，然后我们开始去修大圆满或者是空心。
So with our 7 or 8 years made up of the preliminary practices and the founding of a foundation in shamatha meditation, and we'll move on to the practice of the Dzogchen teachings.
首先啊，去观一个大圆满的定。
So what we need to do at this point is to receive a Dzogchen empowerment.
修五加心也要观定，需要观金刚萨多和莲花生大师的定，但是呢这个时候就必须要观一个大圆满的观定。
Of course, the five inner preliminaries also have their requisite empowerments. They are the Vajrasattva empowerment and the Guru Rinpoche empowerment. However, for the purposes of practicing Dzogchen, then we need the appropriate initiation in the great perfection.
然后这个钉灌了以后呢，大圆满里面就是有一个最高端的、最顶尖的这个一系列的修法。
So after we've received this empowerment, then within the Dzogchen teachings, there are a series of extremely high practices.
然后这个修这些修法呢，也有层次那一步一步的去完成。
So within these high practices of the Dzogchen teachings, they also have their respective stages and levels.
最后我们必须要找到一个真正的有真武的上师。
At this point in time, it's absolutely vital that we have a teacher who is fully awakened.
这样子的上师才能够让我们真悟空性。
Only this kind of teacher is able to assist us in realizing the nature of emptiness.
因为自己没有证悟的话，就根本就不知道所证悟的境界到底是什么样子，所以他没有办法让别人证悟。
Because without having realized the nature of emptiness for oneself, one has no first-hand knowledge, experience of what this state is. So this kind of person or teacher is not in a position to be able to give instructions to another, a student, on how to realize this state.
那么这些上师他就会用他会用两种方法。
Teachers who will assist us in realizing the nature of emptiness essentially have two methods.
一种方法就是传统的保守的，然后也就是所谓的保守，就是非常的符合佛经里面的这个佛陀所讲的这些内容以一个这样子的方式来让我们证悟。
The first of these methods or approaches is a conservative, traditional approach that is in complete accordance with the sutric teachings. The first approach refers to this one, this approach in order to realize the nature of emptiness.
另外一种方法呢，就是非传统的也就是说，看起来表面上不但是不是传统的这种保守的方法，而且跟这个保守的方法有矛盾的一个这样子的方法是一般的人没办法理解的一种方法来让我们证悟。
The second approach or the second method is one that is non-traditional in nature. In fact, it's an approach that seems to be in stark contradiction to the conservative and traditional approach.
如果你照的上师没有错的话没有错的话，那么这两个方法都没问题的，都可以的。
If you've been able to choose or to find for yourself a qualified master without being mistaken, that you've indeed discovered or found for yourself a qualified master, then either of these approaches are both valid.
就像我们生病的时候很多的病就有两种治疗的方法。
It's similar to if we're sick or if we have an illness, that there are two possible ways we can go about healing ourselves.
一个是保守的治疗方法，这个不开刀，不动手术吃药来解决这个问题。
The first of them is a fairly conservative and traditional way to go about curing our illness, which is not to have an operation, not to take medicine.
另外一个呢，他不用这些传统的方法，直接动手术治疗这个病。
The second of these approaches is non-traditional. It's just to go straight to the illness, do an operation, and cure it in that way.
那么，同样的一种病给我们用保守的方法来治疗，还是动手术，还是以我们本人的体质来决定。
So In terms of an illness, what approach is the most appropriate for curing ourselves? Is it to follow or adopt a conservative approach, a traditional approach, a non-traditional approach, or to assess, evaluate what approach to adopt on the basis of the physical condition of the patient?
如果我们的体质比较好，能够承受这个非传统的这个治疗的话，那么就可以接受这样子的治疗，也可以治病，也而且来得更快一些。
Of course, if we have a more stronger physical constitution, then we can adopt the non-traditional approach, which is quicker and more direct, a more quicker and direct way of healing our illness.
如果我们的体质比较弱、比较差啊，不能承受这个动手术。啊，这样子的话，那就保守治疗来得比较慢，但是呢，最终还是可以治病。
However, if our physical constitutions are more feeble and weak and unable to withstand the intrusion of an operation, then the traditional, less invasive way of curing the illness is more appropriate, and at the end of the day, is equally able to.To cure and heal the sickness or disease.
那么最后啊，我们真无空性的时候，上师让我们这种保守的啊这个方法去真无，还是非保守啊不太不好理解的这种方法去真无，这个不是上师决定，是以我们的这个根基决定。
So ultimately, whether or not the approach that we take to achieving awakening is the more traditional approach or the less traditional approach, an approach that we really aren't able to understand particularly easy, is it this ultimately determined by our teacher? No, ultimately what it's determined by is our own capacities.
我们的佛教的历史上的这些大部分的这些成就者，他们都是通过这种保守的传统的方法啊来证悟，也就是先学习思考，最终啊这个修心啊这个一个很保守的方法，最后证悟。
Most of the great masters in the Buddhist tradition who have achieved awakening, achieved enlightenment, have done so by following the more conservative approach, that is by studying, by contemplating, and by practicing the Buddhist teachings, and by this in following this gradual path, ultimately achieving awakening.
但是也有很多很多的人，就是一种非保守的方法，非传统的方法
At the same time, though, there also have been a great number of people who have obtained enlightenment through the non-traditional approaches.
就像印度佛教里面的八十位成就者的这个故事一样。
It's just like the story of the 80 Madhasitas in Indian Buddhism.
在藏传佛教里面，就像米拉日巴大师的证悟的方式
，similar to the way that Milarepa became enlightened in the Tibetan Buddhist tradition。
米拉日巴大师他找到了这个马尔巴大师，他移植马尔巴大师，他希望从马尔巴大师这边能够听到法，能够修心。
Milarepa relied on Marpa, his teacher Marpa.Hoping that through relying on him, wishing that by relying on him, he would be able to receive teachings and consequently, subsequently attain awakening.
然后马尔巴大师呢没有给米拉日巴传法，而让米拉日巴给马尔巴自己的儿子为他的儿子修房子，修了一间又修一间。
But Marpa didn't transmit to Milarepa any teachings. Instead, what he made him do was build a series of houses for his son.
当米拉日巴到了失望、绝望的边缘的时候呢， 然后给他传发官丁，当下就真悟了。
It was only when Milarepa was absolutely on the cusp, the precipice of desperation and desolation, that did Mapa give him empowerments and teachings, upon which Milarepa immediately became enlightened.
但是密拉日巴大师他离开他的上师马尔巴大师的时候呢，最后马尔巴大师给他说了一句话。
However, when Milarepa finally left his teacher, departed from his side, Mapa told him one thing.
那么马尔巴大师给他说什么话呢？他说啊，像我这样子的上师，以后也会很少很少的，像你这样子的这个弟子也是很少的。
What he said was, in the future, teachers like me will be very, very scarce, and at the same time, students like you will also be very, very rare.
所以以后你去啊，这个带你的弟子的时候呢，还是不要用我在你身上用的这些方法。
So in the future, when you have students relying on them and you're guiding them in the path to enlightenment,Don't use the approach that I have used with you.
还是要用一些比较传统保守的方法去带这些你的弟子。
The best thing for you to do is to rely on more conservative and traditional ways to guide your students.
所以这种非传统的非保守的这种方法呢，也有一定的风险。
So,It needs to be appreciated that the non-traditional or less conservative approach entails a degree of risk.
不管是用哪一种方法也好，最后我们要证悟。
Regardless, whichever approach we take or follow, our ultimate goal and what we have to do is realize the nature of emptiness, become awakened.
在汉传佛教里面也是一样，禅宗其实。禅宗它是一个非常了不起的宗派，也就是一个大乘佛教的精华。
It's the same in Chinese Buddhism, and particularly in the Chan tradition, which is a really amazing lineage or tradition in Buddhism, an extremely high teaching.
禅宗到了西方以后呢，大家都叫做禅。然后呢，对这个染的理解可能也有各种各样的理解。
In the West, many people understand Chan, through the name or the name of Zen, and but regarding Zen, have perhaps a number of different understandings as to what this might mean.
实际上，这个禅宗它在讲什么呢？它就在讲明心见性。
Ultimately, what the Chan teachings are aiming for us to realize is to gain insight into the nature of our own minds.
也就是一种非常非传统的一个，在禅宗的历史上的很多的高僧大德他们都是一种不能说他们都是，很多人都以这种。非传统的方式证悟的。
Within the Chan tradition, many masters, many realized beings in the Chan tradition achieved their awakening through non-traditional method.
禅宗的历史上有一个故事在禅宗的历史上有一位非常非常有智慧，非常有。才华的一个佛教的学者。
In the Chan tradition, there was a practitioner who had a great deal of wisdom and had a great deal of talent.
但是他实际上还没有证悟，他只是懂很多很多的道理，但是实际上他还没有证悟。
But he hadn't.Yet become awakened. While he understood a great deal of knowledge, he had not yet realized the nature of emptiness.
然后有一次啊，来了另外一个禅师，就是一个非常了不起的已经证悟的一个禅师。
And one day there came along another Chan master who was extremely high in his state of realization.
然后这位禅师他很早以前就听说过啊这位很聪明的这个人的名声。
And this other master that came along had long before heard about this other Chan master and his great intellect and attainments of knowledge.
然后这位禅师他说他要给这个人要提一个问题。
And so this other Chan master who came along, what he wanted to do was to ask a question of the Chan master with great intellectual attainments.
那么把这个人 叫到他的跟前，然后呢问了一个很深奥的问题。那么这个问题啊，这个人虽然是很聪明的，但是呢他就是答不出这个问题。
So he summons the other Chan master, he called him before him, and put to him an extremely profound question that the other Chan master was not able to answer.
然后这个非常聪明的人就跟这位禅师说啊，我实在是答不出来，那么你给我能不能解释这个问题。
The Chan master with great intellectual attainments, he said to the other master, he said, look, I'm simply not able to answer this question. Can you please explain it to me?
那么这个禅师他说我不给你解释这个问题，你自己去寻找这个答案。
But the other Chan master said, no, I'm not going to explain this question for him, for you. What you need to do is go and investigate it and find the answer for yourself.
然后这个很聪明的人回来以后呢，他把他的书房里面的整个的这个书都翻了一遍，都找不到答案。
So the extremely clever, knowledgeable Chan master, he went to his library and went through every single book in his bookshelf, but was not able to discover the answer to this question.
然后这个人他非常的失望，他说我再也不依靠这些文字上的东西，我一定要去实修。他把这个所有的佛教的这些书都烧掉。
So in great disappointment and disillusionment with all these books, he said, from now on, I'm not going to rely on these texts, these written words. I absolutely need to turn myself to practice. And with that resolve, he burnt all of the books in his possession.
然后到了一个非常偏僻的地方去，自己种地，自己砍柴，自己做饭，自己打坐，这样子度过了三年的时间。
So he went to an extremely remote place.Where he grew his own vegetables, chopped his own wood, made his own food, meditated, and he spent 3 years in this place.
他在这个三年的时间当中一直都在打坐，寻找这个答案，但是呢，他一直都没有证悟。
So even though he spent 3 years in this place in constant meditation, he still wasn't able to achieve awakening. He wasn't able to find the answer to that question.
那么有一天呢，他种地挖土的时候呢，就挖出了一个这地里面呢挖出了一个洼片。洼片就是盖房子的洼的洼片啊，对，对。
But one day when he was digging in the earth, he dug up a piece of tile from the tile eaves on a roof of a house.
那么种菜的时候呢，这个地里面不能有瓦片啊、石头啊、木这些都不能有的，他要清理干净的。那么他把这个瓦片拿上来，往后面一扔。
Of course, when you're growing vegetables in the field, you can't have, you know, bricks or tiles or pieces of wood in the earth. So he picked up this piece of tile and threw it behind him.
就是因为巧合，他把这个瓦片往后一扔，正好就打在一个柱子上面。
And it just so happened that when he threw this piece of tile backwards, it collided with a piece of bamboo.
大到这个柱子上面一啪的一声的时候呢，发出了一个这样子的声音的时候呢。
I'm sorry, I said bamboo instead of pillar. The tile, when it was thrown backwards, collided with a pillar.
因为这个声音，然后呢，他就立即就当下证悟了，恍然大悟。
And it was the sound of that tile colliding against the pillar, the sound of this contact taking place, on hearing the sound of this contact taking place, that his awakening was achieved in an instant.
他真正的体会，他真正的证悟了他的心的本心，明心见性。
And it was at this exact point that he fully and fundamentally realized the state of his own mind.
然后他特别的高兴。
And he was extremely overjoyed.
立即就向这位禅师住的地方，向这个方向磕三个头。
And immediately turned himself in the direction of the other Chan master and prostrated three times.
然后瓦地的这个锄头都扔到天里面，到房间去洗澡换衣服。
And threw the spade that he was digging in the earth into the field behind him and ran indoors to bathe himself, get himself clean and change into a fresh set of clothes.
马上就出发，就寻找三年前的这位上师啊，这位禅师。
And set out at once in order to find that Chan master who 3 years beforehand had put to him the mysterious question.
他同时也知道了，那个时候这位禅师为什么不给他解释这个问题。
And at this time he came to understand, he understood why it was that the Chan Master 3 years ago refused to tell him the answer to the question.
他知道这个时候如果这位禅师把这个问题给他解释的话，他会明白这个意思，但是呢，不属于是他的啊，还是属于是这位禅师的观点，因为他没有证悟，所以这个是不属于他自己的。
He understood that if the Chan Master 3 years beforehand had told him the answer to the question, that while he might have understood the answer in a conceptual sense on its surface, he wouldn't have really understood it in an embodied experiential way. The knowledge that the words of the answer may have given him would not have belonged to him. It wouldn't be his knowledge. It wouldn't be his own experience.
Number.通过三年的努力啊，现在他找到的这个答案就不属于别人的，而属于自己的，是自己悟出来的。
But by the same token, through his 3 years of hard endeavor in meditation, the answer that he finally obtained was not something that belonged to anybody else. It was really, truly his own realization.
然后他知道这个为什么三年前这个禅师。给他提问题，然后又不给他解释这个问题的时候呢，他非常非常的感谢，感激不已。
And in understanding why it was the teacher didn't give him the answer 3 years ago, he was filled with a great sense of gratitude towards this teacher.
然后他去找这个三年前给他问题的这个禅师，然后呢，给这位禅师说：“我现在找到了这个答案。”然后呢。说出来，这个禅师也非常的高兴，知道他开悟了，真悟了。
So when he was able to track down this Chan master, he said to him, "Finally, I know the answer to the question." And this Chan master was extremely happy on hearing that he knew that the other Chan master had realized the nature of his mind and that he had become awakened.
那么，这个禅师的身边。还有一位禅师，也就是他的同学，就是这个禅师的同学，另外一个禅师，对
The Chan master who would put the question to the knowledgeable Chan master had by his side another Chan master, one of who was his classmate.
那么这位禅师呢，他还是有点不相信，因为这个人嘴巴特别的会说，所以呢，他不一定证悟了，我得要亲自去，要去看看这个到底是不是真的证悟了。
And this other Chan master was still not utterly convinced by the realization that the knowledgeable, clever Chan master had made. He thought, you know, this guy, he's really good with words, he's really eloquent and articulate, and I don't necessarily trust what he says with his words. I'm going to find out and verify that he is in fact awakened.
那么他们在这个交谈的过程当中呢，他也发现他是真正的证悟了。
But in the course of their communication, their exchange, he discovered that he was really, in fact, awakened.
这个就是非传统的证悟的方式。在这个之前，学了这么多的佛经，不证悟啊，就是一个外篇啊，大在后面的这个柱子上的，就是这个声音让他证悟了。很奇怪的，莫名其妙的一个证悟的方式。
So when we talk about the non-traditional or non-conservative approach to awakening, then really this was it. Someone who had spent so many years on sutric study and intellectual investigation without any result, and then finally through the collision of a tile with a pillar, the very sound of it awakening. Well, this indeed is an extremely whimsical and mysterious thing indeed.
还有一个啊，有以前一百多年前啊，在藏地也有两位啊，一个修大圆满的上师和他的弟子两个人一起在山洞里面修行。
And similarly, more than 100 years ago in Tibet, there was a teacher and his student.Who were practicing in a cave together?
他们的生活很艰苦啊。那么有一天呢，他们两个啊，有一个这个锅盔啊，那么一个锅盔一个饼啊，要两个人要分开吃，一半一半的吃。
The lifestyle they led was pretty basic, pretty rough. One day they had a flat round bread that they were going to separate in.Half each eating one half of the bread.
那么他的弟子啊，准备把这个饼开始分两半的时候呢，他的上师问这个饼的头在哪里，尾在哪里呢？问一个很奇怪的问题。
Just when his student was proceeding to separate the bread into two parts, his teacher asked him a question, a strange question. He said.What is the head of this piece of bread, and what is its tail?
那么，那个他的这个弟子，他想了一下，到底这个他一开始的时候也没有注意到，他想了一下，这个饼头尾在哪里？然后饼就是一个圆形的东西，这个根本不会有哪里是头，哪里是尾。这样子的时候一愣啊，然后在这个瞬间，他就恍然大悟，证悟了。
So his student was sort of stunned for a moment. He thought, yeah, really, this round piece of bread, where is its head? Where is its tail? And in this moment of contemplation, he suddenly, in an instant, became awakened.
这些人为什么这样子的莫名其妙的情况下证悟呢？因为他们在这个之前证悟空性的这些所有的条件都已经非常非常的成熟了。
Now, why is it that these masters have been able to obtain awakening in such a strange and improbable way? The reason is that their prior foundations of practice have been extremely stable and strong.
就像我们啊，秋天或者是冬天的时候，这个很成熟的这些树叶啊。一个轻轻的风吹来的时候，这些树叶都会掉下来的。
It's like in autumn or winter, when a very light breeze blows by, the leaves fall gently and without force from the branches.
同样的，这些人啊，这个在这个之前出离心、菩提心啊，还有忏悔自己的罪过、积累福报、对上师的这种信心，所有的这些条件非常的这个成熟，所以他们可以一种很莫名其妙的方式证悟了。
And it's in this same manner that students whose foundations are firmly in place, their renunciation, their bodhicitta, their confession practices, their respect for their teacher, their accumulation of merits, upon this extremely strong foundation, they're able to finally obtain enlightenment in a non-traditional and perhaps quite improbable moment.
就像中国的禅宗的这个第六祖六祖慧能大师啊，那么他在他的上师五祖弘忍大师的这个一句话啊，他就证悟了。
It's just like the sixth patriarch of Chan Buddhism, Hui Neng, who was able to attain enlightenment upon hearing one statement one series of words from the mouth of his own teacher.
那么一句话，这一句话呢，就是《金刚经》里面的一句话。
The statement, the sentence, that was spoken to him by his teacher was one that comes from the Diamond Sutra.
那么我们很多人天天都在念《金刚经》啊，念了20年、30年，为什么不证悟呢？
Of course, there are so many people who are constantly reciting the Diamond Sutra, maybe every day for 20 or 30 years. Why is it that they haven't yet obtained enlightenment?
而刘祖慧能大师就是《金刚经》里面的一句话，一下子为什么一开始听到、第一次听到的时候就证悟了呢？
Whereas Hui Neng, the patriarch Hui Neng, upon hearing just one line from the Diamond Sutra, was able to become awakened. Why is this?
就是因为我们的基础不扎实啊，不成熟啊。慧能大师的基础成熟，所以啊，他就很一句话就证悟了，而我们不证悟。
The reason is that the Hui Neng patriarch's foundation of practice was extremely stable, was extremely durable, was extremely mature.And it was on this basis that he was able to obtain awakening upon hearing a single remark. Whereas others, most of us by comparison, lack that strong foundation.
最后再简单的介绍一下他们证悟的是什么东西。
Finally, we're going to talk about what it actually was that these masters realized.
他们发现啊，他们的心啊，他们的心，他们的所有的情绪，他们的所有的念头啊，都是虚幻的啊，就是空心虚幻。
What they discovered was that their minds, that all of their thoughts, that all of their moods and emotions were ultimately illusory in nature, empty in nature.
同时他们也证悟了，他们也体会了外在的这个世界外在的这个世界，也就是就像我们做梦的时候的梦境一样也是一个虚拟的世界，虚幻的世界。
And at the same time, they realized that the external world as we know it is all but an illusory appearance.
他们深深地体会到外在的世界、内在的世界，这个世界里面呢，两个世界里面都没有一个真实的，一切都是虚幻的世界的时候呢，这个虚拟的世界不会给他们带来恐慌、烦恼。
What they realized was upon realizing the illusory nature of both the external world and their internal selves, that this, upon realizing this, these illusory worlds ceased to be able to generate fear for them.
因为我们的这个焦虑、恐慌、 悲伤啊，还有就是等等啊，所有的还有就是贪嗔痴啊，贪和嗔啊等等这些所有的烦恼，都建立在这个我们对这些物质和内外世界的执着的基础上。
Because ultimately, all of our negative emotions and obscurations, greed, desire, hatred, ignorance, anxiety, fear, etc., are ultimately all founded on an attachment or a clinging to illusory phenomena.
那么当他们亲身体会到啊这个基础不存在的时候呢，然后建立在这个基础上的所有的烦恼也都会瓦解。
So, when they personally, very profoundly realized the nature of the truth of existence, then all of their previous negative motions and defilements dissipated.
这个时候呢，因为他们啊，这个啊，证悟了空心，或者是他们深深的体会到这个世界是虚幻。然后他们把所有的这些这个世界给他们带来的这些所有的痛苦啊，所有的烦恼，逐步逐步的都减少，最终啊，所有都断除。
By realizing the nature of emptiness and the illusory nature of existence, gradually, stage by stage, their negative emotions and afflictions.were able to dissolve, be done away with.
那么这样子以后呢，他就证悟了这个空性以后，同时他对没有证悟的这些人产生了巨大的这个慈悲心。
So at the same time, upon having realized emptiness and of having ridded oneself of one's previously held afflictions,The person who has attained awakening also generates great compassion for all of those others.
那个时候呢，他特别特别的想把也让其他人证悟，也就是让其他人也明白这个道理。
At this point in time, the awakened person has an immensely strong desire to.Help other beings to similarly become awakened and to understand the truth of existence.
所以他从此以后就是投入这个工作当中，也就是让别人明白这个道理这个工作当中。
So from this point onwards, the awakened person fully invests themselves in the work of helping others to learn these truths and to.Become awakened themselves.
因为这个时候他就发现我们所有人的这个生老病死，还有尤其是我们的精神上的这些痛苦，都是使我们自己创造出来的这个世界带来的一些负面的现象，根本就不存在的，根本就没有必要去受这样子的痛苦，所以他特别的希望大家都能够明白这个道理。
Because what the awakened person realizes at this point is that so much of our ostensible samsaric suffering and our inner pain as well is something that we have really made for ourselves. It's not out there in objective existence, and it's the desire to help other people to understand this reasoning, understand this truth that they.Embark on the work of liberating other beings.
所以这个时候呢，他对其他的众生特别这个产生慈悲心。然后呢，他这个时候呢，因为证悟了空性那么他自己就是没有这个去利益众生的这个阻碍。所有的障碍，所有的阻碍都断掉了。然后呢，从此以后呢，他的唯一的工作就是利益众生。 度化众生。
So upon generating this deep compassion, this great compassion, having realized the nature of emptiness, then the barriers or obstructions to benefiting other beings, simply fall away, and the awakened person from here on in devotes themselves single-mindedly to the task of helping others.
那么从此以后呢，他再也不会害怕这个时节。
And from this point onward, the awakened person will no longer feel fear for the world around them.
佛经里面有一句话啊，它是形容这个时候的这个状态。
There is a saying in Buddhism, or a way of describing this state of being.
啊，就是四句话，给大家念一下这个时候的状态是什么样子呢？佛经里面说，观法。汝之患、啊、是什么意思呢？法、啊、它的意思是整个这个世界，观就是观察或者是看到这个一切万事万物都是虚幻、啊、就像做梦一样、啊、这叫做观法止、汝之患、啊、大概这个意思翻译一下就可以了。
So there are four lines to this saying that describes this state. The first in Chinese, 观法如之幻, refers to realizing that the nature, the illusory nature of the phenomenal world around us.
第二句话，观生入如缘啊，最后的缘是这个华缘啊，华缘的意思，也就是说，观啊。观生就是投生啊，对这个证悟空性的人来说，投生就是从一个花园再进入另外一个花园一样啊，因为他不害怕，很喜欢这个世界，这个喜欢呢也不是贪著，也不是贪啊，但是他喜欢，他为什么喜欢呢？他会继续讲。
The second line refers to.The awakened person no longer feeling fear for rebirth, and in fact, rebirth appearing to the awakened person as merely passing from one garden, one pleasure garden to the next. However, while enjoying this world, the awakened person does not feel greed or attachment towards it.
最后的两句就说，若称若不称。何苦解无怖，怖就是恐怖的怖啊，就是说若称是说当他成功的时候啊，若不称是或者是不成功失败的时候啊，不管他成功或者是失败的时候呢，然后这个烦恼和这个痛苦都不能给他带来任何的这个啊恐惧。就是这个意思，因为他证悟了空心。
And the third line refers to the awakened person who has realized the nature of emptiness, no longer feeling fear towards success or failure in life. So regardless of whether the things they do are successful or whether they meet with failure, they're no longer moved or afflicted by the negative emotions that conventionally arise from these experiences.
这四句话就是讲这个证悟空性的结果。
And these statements, these sayings are describing what the result of realizing emptiness is.
就是说我们证悟了空性以后呢，万事万物都知道是像虚幻虚拟这样子虚拟的世界一样的时候呢，然后他自己没有任何的啊，在这个世界上，他成功也好，他失败也好，他就不执着这些，他都没有任何烦恼，都没有任何的这个恐惧。
So what this is talking about is the awakened person who have, upon having realized the nature of emptiness, is no longer afflicted by negative emotions, by fear, because realizing the illusory nature of the world around them.They have no need to, or they're not in a, they're no longer in a state where they're, their success or their failure in this world is something that they believe in the objective existence of.
那么这个时候呢，他真正的获得了这个彻底的获得了自由。
At this point in time, the awakened person has attained, fully attained, completely obtained ultimate freedom.
这个世界上的任何一个事情都不能影响到他。
Nothing that happens in their life or in this world will be able to impact upon that.
他的内心啊，就得到啊，就获得了一个彻底的，获得了一个巨大的，或者是彻底的自由。所以呢，这个万事万物都不能控制，不能影响到他的心。
So, upon obtaining this ultimate freedom,No longer are external things happening in the world able to negatively impact upon or control the mental state of an awakened person.
所以，或者是成功，或者是不成功，失败啊，这个世界都对他都没不能带来恐惧，就是这个原因。
So the reason, this is the reason why the awakened person is.Not able to be driven to fear by what happens in the world, whether success occurs or whether failure happens.
然后当他自己啊，就发现了这个真理的时候啊，发现了这个道理的时候呢，他特别的希望啊，其他人也能够这个证悟同样的道理，所以他特别的喜欢啊，就是。让别人明白这个道理。
So when the awakened person discovers this truth, when they discover this truth for themselves, they generate in their own minds a really sincere wish that others too can discover this same truth.
所以从此以后呢，他不管是投身到这个天界啊，不管是投身到人间啊，不管他投身到这个。旁生当中啊，动物当中也好，他发喜充满，特别特别的喜欢。他就是不管是投身到什么地方也好，他就像一个花园，一个非常非常漂亮的花园公园里面呢，再到另外一个花园和公园一样。
So no matter in which realm they take rebirth from here on in, whether it's in the realm of the gods, or in the realm of animals, or in the human realm.It's just like arriving in another wonderful garden.
这个时候，这个时机啊，对他来说，就是变成一个非常完美的、非常美丽的，像一个花园一样。
And the world around them appears to them as an extremely beautiful and an extremely perfect garden.
那么这个时候呢，他没有烦恼，然后有巨大的这个慈悲心。然后他的工作不是赚钱，那么他的工作就是为了帮助别人啊。从此以后呢，他真正的啊证悟了，那么他的心灵啊得到了精华，他的生命已经提升了啊。这个就是我们的人生的目标。
So at this point, when a person, the awakened person, has generated this great compassion.Is no longer afflicted by negative emotions when their work is no longer mundane jobs, but the task, the great project of liberating others. Then this person has succeeded in upgrading their human existence, our ultimate goal.
那么我们每一个人的这个生命啊，可以提升，可以提升到这个级别，可以完全可以提升到这个级别。我们每一个人。都有这样子的机会，我们每一个人都有这样子的选择，所以啊，有这么好的选择，有这么好的机会，啊的这种人生啊是非常难得的。哎，说回来，最后还是深深的体会到，哦，因为我们这个人生可以做这么好的事情，这么伟大的事情，所以我们的人生才是非常非常啊有价值啊这样子。
And every single human being.Is able to upgrade them, their existences in this way. Every single human being has the opportunity to do so. And this is indeed a wonderful thing.
这个时候呢，我们对这个世界、对未来、对自己的生命啊，就是充满希望啊，非常有信心啊。然后呢，就是我们发现啊，我们的目标、我们的方向，从此以后呢，我们的这个生活处处都非常有活力。
And from this point in time, we generate a new appreciation of our lives, of our world, of our future. We have a renewed sense of energy, a great sense of hope and optimism.
这个时候我们懂得啊，珍惜自己的生命，珍惜我们身边的一切。
And at this point, we really truly know to cherish our human existences and indeed to cherish everything around us.
好，我们今天啊，这个子如何证悟空心的这个啊，这堂课呢，啊，就讲到这里，给大家简单的概念性的、框架性的啊，就指出一个如何证悟的一个这个次第，但是呢。很多的具体的这个修行的方法呢，我们还是要进一步的去学习。那么我们啊，这个加利福尼亚州这个地方呢，也有很多很多的这个藏传佛教的啊，这个中心，也有很多我们今天在座还有前几天的这些上师啊，都是很不错的啊。那么我们可以一些很具体的这些东西呢，我们可以在他们那里可以学习啊。那么除了藏传佛教以外呢？啊，这个地方可能还有很多其他的，像，啊，这个南传佛教，啊，汉传佛教，那也可能也有很多其他的这个佛教的中心啊。那么这些中心当中呢，也应该有很多的这些，法师、禅师啊。那么我们也可以从他们那里啊吸收正能量啊，学习佛法的智慧啊。这样子的话呢，那我们啊可以。自利利他啊，非常非常好的。
So this brings to the end tonight's teaching on the stages, the gradual steps to the path of becoming awakened. What we've spoken about tonight has been a rough overview of the path, the stages of the path that we have to progress along. But in terms of concrete.The actual concrete nitty-gritty of practice, we still need to engage in further study. But for this purpose in the Bay Area, there are a lot of Tibetan Buddhist centers. There are also a lot of centers in other Buddhist traditions, in the Hinayana tradition and in the Chinese Buddhist traditions. Tonight we have...We have Tibetan teachers with us here present. It's important that we take advantage of the opportunity to benefit from the energy that teachers in these traditions can give us in our practice along the path.
好，我们的今天的课到此结束，非常感谢大家。好，我们最后大家回向。
We're going to dedicate our merit now.
So nam de dam je zo ba ne do me ni be da na ba je za je ga na je wa na de ba de bim zo le do wa do lo so om a ho ba zeng ge re ba ma se de Om Aum Bhajangara Bhama Sadhum Om Aum Bhajangara Bhama Sadhum Labhasandangar Munzambhaji Dibya Chodji Nidra Yungay当得小主小月正对当得小主你别扎西手